Gurudev Shri Shri Ravi Shankar has taken spirituality to the farthest corners of the world. His meditation and breathing techniques have deeply touched and transformed the lives of over 450 million people in 156 countries by helping them find freedom from stress and negativity. He inspires the highest human values of love, compassion, and togetherness by uniting people from all cultures in a spirit of service and belongingness. He has shown us again and again that the whole world is indeed one family. Dinesh Vijan is a highly successful producer in Hindi cinema, having made box office successes like Love Aajkal, Cocktail, Hindi Medium and Stree. He has also given a platform to many stories that would otherwise not get told, having given up a lucrative banking job 14 years ago to pursue films. The risk has certainly paid off. Presenting Dinesh Vijan in a heart-to-heart with Gurudev Shri Shri Ravi Shankar.
Hello, Dinesh.
How are you, Gurudev?
Very good. More busy than usual, doing all these calls, online programs, courses.
So been very hectic, helping others deal with this situation. That our forefathers haven't seen.
Correct. And the whole world today is connected through internet. So that is something, you know, that technology makes it easy. Yeah.
It's the only industry which is doing well. Means, as you can see, internet has connected the world and brought it closer. It's also showed us a new way to communicate.
Correct.
Can I ask a few questions if you'd allow
me? Yeah, go ahead. Yeah, sure.
You know, in this time, like, you know, most people that I meet my age are very scared these days of death. And obviously with this pandemic, which is almost like a game of Russian roulette, who it hits. So the fear has even got exaggerated. So why do human beings fear death so much? You know, we've been born and we know we're going to die, including me. Like, you know, the thought of not existing. So why is that fear there and how can one deal with it?
Fear is always about the unknown. And death is unknown to us. That's why we fear. But now, how to deal with that fear? Now here, you know, when you see life from a broader perspective, broader picture of life, then you will see this fear keeps thinning and ultimately dies out.
Okay. But in our daily basis, like, you know, I understand it's the fear of the unknown. But it creates anxiety, and it's creating an anxiety for a lot of people. So is there some exercise or something you can do to just...
Yes. You know, here, Ujjayi breathing, pranayama is very good. That will help you. Moreover, see, fear is not there when there is love. Say, suppose a soldier who is going for war in Kargil, he has no fear. Someone who has put their 100% in an adventure, there is no fear. People go to Mount Everest, they are not sure whether they'll be coming back, right? So when you take some really adventurous journey, your fear will go away, number one. When you dedicate yourself to something 100%, then also fear vanishes. And if there is a deep sense of love, commitment, that also, you know, makes the fear vanish. And one more thing, but this is a negative connotation. Utter hatred also removes fear.
Love and hate are the same, different, same coin. Yeah. Well said. You know, Gurudev, I had the, I was lucky that I got to spend time with Irfan. I made a film called Angrezi Medium, you know, and I was supposed to make it before he fell sick. And then he took a year and he recovered and we shot that film. So when I used to spend time with him, you know, he said something very interesting to me. He said that, you know, before getting cancer, his mind was constantly ruling him. it was relentlessly making him do things which, whether he did, he need it, did he not need it, but it was almost like you're on autopilot. Okay, this, whether it's success, money, films, travel. He said he wouldn't change anything that had happened to him because it made him understand that when you get free of your mind, you know, and you realize actually how powerful it is. So he believed that we're only using such a small part of our mind.
Correct.
And once he could let go, he felt so free and liberated that he wouldn't change the experience for anything else. How does one, you know, whether it's for the traditional things that we know or that which have been induced on us since birth, you know, you've got to do well, and you know, success is measured in terms of tangible variables and not the intangible. How can one control one's mind and, you know, what, before it's too late?
That is where the meditation, Sudarshan Kriya, these techniques come in handy, you know. When you do these techniques, you experience that freedom. No doubt you have your mind, you have your ambition, you have your goals you want to achieve. You get even brilliant ideas, but you see you are not them and you are much bigger than this chattering mind we have. That is where, you know, meditation is being appreciated by people all over. Sometimes, you know, when you know you are going to die and the life is going to end, then also someone gets into this alertness. When we become aware of the truth in life that one day this body is going to disintegrate, suddenly there is a shift within you. An awareness comes, your consciousness is broadened. And that is the secret of happiness.
How do we get to do that earlier? Like, I've always, you know, I feel that there are two kinds of people in the world. One who change and understand that, you know, changes for the better, and one who are very rigid, right? So I'm somebody who likes to change, but sometimes you kind of try and make it when it's convenient for you. How can you do that early on?
Yeah. We can do it in half a second. Can you see the entire past as a dream? Is it more than a dream in your mind right now? You made so many films, you went to school, college, blah, 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 all these years. Is it not like a dream right now, this moment?
Absolutely.
And could this be a dream? Right now you are sitting, I am talking to you. And this will be finished in next another few minutes, half an hour or so. Isn't it like a dream?
Absolutely is.
And see the future, another 20, 30 years, maybe you will be on this planet. And every day will pass like this, some happy day, some unhappy day, some success. And finally, after some time, you retire, you say, no, I'm not going to do anything, I'm going to just relax. And or you may want to work all your life and then one day you're not there. Is it not like a dream the next 20, 30 years? If you project your mind, you'll feel even that is a dream, right? This is the awakening actually. When you see everything as a dream, suddenly you become very alert and happy from deep within. You know, Dinu, when you are happy, what is the experience we have? Something in you is expanding, isn't it?
Yeah.
Happiness is associated with a sense of something is expanding. And when you are unhappy, you feel there is something shrinking inside of you, right? If someone insults you, something in you shrinks. So this expansion and shrinking of our consciousness usually depends on circumstances, situation, people, what they say, you know, what they do, all that stuff, right? But if you determine, okay, I am not going to shrink by others' comments, or I am going to just fly because someone is praising me. I am going to be master of my own consciousness, my own mind. That makes a lot of difference. Otherwise, our mind gets rattled by what? Just few words or acts of other people, right?
But does that also make you detached, Gurudev? Because I am a bit like that. Because I think over the years, what I've tried to change is that I have the ability to almost, I've tried to develop an ability where I can step out and look at my action and, you know, judge it for what it is. So, and that really has helped me, because otherwise when you're in the moment, you have so many emotions riding you that you sometimes can't see things for what they are. So I always believe there are three sides to every everything that happens, yours, mine, and actually what happened. And, you know, with time, if you step out and replay it, you'll be able to see the other person's point of view, right or wrong, and you'll be able to correct yourself. But if you constantly are unaffected by the world, do you get very detached? And is that a problem?
Detached and yet being active, that is the right balance. You know, if you detach, it is not like, there is two type of detachment. One is when people get depressed, they are totally detached of everything. They don't care. They just start caving into themselves, right? This type of detachment is no good. There is another detachment which does just the opposite. You are detached, but you are very happy about it. As I say, in the ground, the people who are watching the game are more happier than the people who are playing. Because people who are playing are in tension.
Absolutely. When you're in the room, yeah, well said. I was always curious about this, which is connected to death, which is afterlife. In the Mahabharata, Duryodhana is seen as a villain, like in the traditional sense, who was jealous of the Pandavas and tried, every mean to destroy them. Yet, I think it is said that he went to heaven and the Pandavas went to hell. Is that correct? And why did that happen? And how does karma play a role here?
No, it's not that Pandavas went to hell. It said only Duryodhana also went to heaven because he fought a Yodha's war. Whether the reason for the war is right or not, but he was a soldier who fought and died and sacrificed himself or died. It's like, you make a movie, whether there is a villain or hero. For you, both villain and heroes are equally important. Parda girne ke baad, hame kya, hum dono, villain and hero, dono ke saath toh party banate ho. So, ye Mahabharata bhi aisa hi ek leela hi toh hai.
I'm saying in terms of actions, jo aap bol rahe hai ke aisa hai ke agar somebody is fighting for the cause and the cause has a negative connotation, but if he's honorable to that cause, that's the reason he went to heaven? In the Mahabharata,
it says that he attained freedom, liberation, attained freedom because Lord Krishna was there the whole time guiding. His last breath happened in front of Krishna. So this is one thing. You see, the divine was present right there. And so he attained liberation. It's not because of the wrong action that he got it. You know, every individual has got some good action, some wrong action. Same is with Ravan also. Ravan jab marte hain, to Ravan Ram mein sama jate hain. Ravana's spirit goes and merges into Rama. This only talks about the Advaita philosophy. That is, there is only one being, one self, which is beyond all duality. And everything is that monologue. The whole universe is monologue of Parabrahman. One Brahman, one spirit, one divinity.
Beautiful, beautifully put, Gurudev. So Gurudev, when we talk about ego, according to Freud, the ego is the mediator between our basic instinct and our moral compass. But I also believe that ego makes you headstrong, makes you strong, but also doesn't let you forgive. When you know someone has wronged you, it becomes very difficult to forgive. And that's an action which is bad for the other person, but also for you. So what is the role of ego in your life? And, how can you kind of give it up and forgive easily?
Correct. When you identify yourself with a thought, a feeling, an emotion, or any other identity, you hold on to it. And that's how the ego gets expressed in the world. Now, in ego also, there are three types of ego. The sattvic ego, rajasic ego, and tamasic ego. Sattvic ego is good to achieve something big, taking steps to, bold steps to achieve something big. All the risky steps, all this is taken by a sattvic ego. Sattvic ego is also identifying with everybody. And then next comes the rajasic ego. Rajasic ego is sometimes stifling, sometimes is gives us happiness. You know, that gives you confidence, that gives you spirit to fight and all that stuff. Tamasic ego is something in which it is not only destroys other, destroys oneself. When people are getting destroyed by their own ego, by their adamancy, they are refusing to see others' point of view, refusing to see any reasoning, but just being so adamant and holding on to a position. This I would call it as a tamasic ego. The journey of life should be from tamasic ego to rajasic, from rajasic to sattvic. So there is nothing wrong with ego. Ego you can have, but I only say don't show it off all the time. Keep it with you, only when it is needed show it. That's what I say to youngsters.
Also, you know, there was an exercise that helped me. So initially when I was much younger, I think it was, I would always wonder that why is this person saying that about myself, about me? Like what you started by telling me. And I realized an interesting thing to look at it, what I realized later in time when, my dad used to tell me that, okay, in your head, you think you're this person, but you've actually not reached there, but that's your aspiration. So whenever someone tells you something that you're not like that, you get upset. But the moment you understand that there is some progress to get there and you can understand you're not there, that 90% of your problems with the world will be different, because you'll be like, okay, I understand, but I aspire to get there, and you'll, you know, solve conflict. So that really helped me a lot in my younger days. You know, lately there's a lot of, there's Art of Living. There are so many people who are telling you to live the so-called right way. But when a child is born, there's so much competition that he's put into. Whether it's in school, he needs to come first. Whether he is grown up, he needs to make money. He needs to give his, this whichever career path he's chosen, he needs to bring his best. And they say you must not have the seven deadly sins. You should not be jealous. You should not have envy. You should not have greed. But the basic system inculcates that in you. So how is it that we balance our self goals without, keeping these sins at check?
You know, all these trends, negative trends, when they come, we should not say that, oh, you should not have. Then the more we fight with it,
the more they come.
The more they come. Why we say some of these emotions are negative is, in your natural state, they don't come. They come when you lack energy or lack understanding. Then the negative emotions take over you. But they're all part of life. You must take, like, you must learn to accept everything. When we say we should not do that, then, you know, it becomes much difficult to handle the mind. All that we need to do is just let things be. And of course, some practices do help you to raise your energy level. When your energy is up, naturally, none of the negative emotions stay for long.
You know, I lost my father 7 years ago, and I actually, had the most beautiful equation, the most beautiful goodbye, and I lost him suddenly. My younger sister was very, very close to him. And, so actually this question is more for her. You know, sometimes we hold on to the past. We hold on to memories. They say time is the best healer, but you don't want to let go of a person. You don't want to let go of a feeling. It's almost like a comfortable feeling that you want to go back to. So how can you almost reach a case of a comfortable remembrance of the past rather than evoking a lot of sadness in you?
Some attention on the knowledge will help. Knowledge, philosophical knowledge, Vedantic knowledge, a little bit attention on that, reading Yoga Vasishtha, reading Bhagavad Gita, these things would help us to come out of that gloomy mindset. You know, what happens sometimes, all these memories of the past, someone very, very dear, one has left the planet, and then you are suffering from those memories, time definitely eases it out. You cannot have the same intensity of feeling what you had, say, 5 years back. To come back to the reality that we are living in, meditation would definitely help them. You know, so many people come here who, and then, you know, they come sobbing and they go back smiling. They just sit with themselves and meditate, see life from a broader perspective.
Very interesting. I had, you know, like you said, in the Gita, it said one must do one's actions selflessly, known as nishkam karma. Can you, like, it's, can you just explain that in simpler terms? Like, you know, what does it actually mean and what's the meaning of that?
See, you do many action expecting joy out of it, right?
Yeah.
You are doing something and you are producing a film, and what you expect? You expect people to be happy about it, correct? People to enjoy it, people to recognize your work. This is sakam karma. You wanted some result and you are acting. But you do some other actions in which is an expression of joy rather than expecting joy. Like, you have birthday, then you give some things to people, sweets to people. Or on a Diwali, you just go and give some gifts to others. What do you expect from them? Another set of gifts? If you are expecting gift and giving a gift, it's no gift at all. So you go and give them some gift, or you wish someone on a birthday. This is all nishkam karma. You have nothing to gain from that act, but you are doing those acts as an expression of happiness. If you are doing something for the good of everybody, that can also be called as nishkam karma. Yeah, you are doing some work, it has to be done, but you are not expecting any big result out of it. That is also called nishkam karma.
You know, another question, Gurudev, that has intrigued me for the last so many years, how important are genes? So it's the nature and the nurture conversation that what defines you, the person you're born with, whether we say gene, whether we say who we are, whether it says our soul, that plays an important role, or the life we live.
You know, there are certain things that we need to understand when we want to, think about life in this direction. See, you are made up of both matter and spirit. Your body is made up of amino acid, carbohydrate, protein, and all that stuff. And your consciousness is made up of sanskaras, impressions, memories, commitment, love, peace, joy, creativity. These are all part of the consciousness, spirit. No certain qualities we carry from the past life. So some of those seeds are there. Now, some is from your parents. Say 25% of your sanskaras are there, 25% is from your parents, their DNA, you know, made our body, and you carry that in your body, those tendencies of parents as well. And then 25% we acquire from our environment, and another 25% is your freedom. You can make, you can think, and you can change the way you want. So our freedom is only 25%. The rest 75% we carry on from the past.
So if any part of your so-called parts are complicated, the others can come together and help you overcome them.
Correct.
I've always been very, intrigued by deja vu. Like this, I think science has described deja vu as an electrical glitch in the brain's matrix. What are your thoughts on this phenomena? Is there a correlation to the past?
When they did research on consciousness in America, I have read somewhere that how consciousness can perceive the events that's going to happen in the future, in the time and space scale. So deja vu is also one such experience in the consciousness. Like people can predict the future, people can remember the past, even past life. In the same way, the consciousness in which all the experiences are there. So when that gets triggered within us, this deja vu experience.
So you feel it is nothing to do with our past life, or does it?
It can be with about the past also. It can be about the future also.
It is said the spoken truth. You know, it's, we take it very lightly. Is an important step towards enlightenment, to be able to speak the truth. However, in the modern world, we seldom speak our minds because there are so many social, norms to follow, like courtesy, respect, self-preservation. How do we navigate this modern world, which, you know, comes in the way of it?
Actually, it's not what we speak. Truth is something that cannot be spoken also. Truth is much beyond the words. You know, our words are just what we try to catch the truth. See, what we speak is not what is truth. What we are is what truth is. You know, our integrity, our state of consciousness. That is what his truth is. Now, in the name of truth, in the name of righteousness, we do a lot of foolishness.
Yeah.
You know, most of the conflicts that arises from the feeling that I am righteous. You know, I am right. So, main sahi hoon, ye bhav nahi ho to koi lad bhi nahi sakta. Ladne ke liye bhi ye bhav ki zarurat padta. I am right. एक संस्कृत में एक बहुत सुंदर कपलेट है, इन दैट इट से सत्यम ब्रूयात प्रियम ब्रूयात न ब्रूयात सत्यम अप्रियम प्रियंच नानृतम न ब्रूयात येष धर्म सनातन. व्हाट इज सनातन धर्म? दैट इज वेर यू स्पीक ट्रूथ एंड यू स्पीक स्वीट एंड यू डोंट स्पीक बिटर ट्रूथ और अनप्लेजेंट ट्रूथ एंड प्लेजेंट लाइज. So not to say pleasant lies and unpleasant truth at the same time, this is the ancient path.
Who would be unpleasant truth then?
Unpleasant truth is those things which if you speak, with it will only bring hurt in others but doesn't do any good. Like someone is, suppose someone is blind. If you call him blind, there is nothing wrong. You have said the right thing. But your calling so is going to hurt them a lot. Right? See, a person who has done a mistake is already aware, oh, I have done a mistake. You keep on telling them you have done this mistake, done that mistake. You are telling the truth. But they are already hurt and you are putting more salt on their wound, right? This is unpleasant truth. And many times those truth which has no apparent value or goodness that it would unfold in life can be taken as unpleasant truth. At the same time, don't tell pleasant lies. Ye khushamadi karne ke liye baatein karte na. I said not to say that. Just to please somebody, tell all sorts of lies. Not to do that also.
Another burning issue, Gurudev, right now is that the disparity in the world, and which, you know, in a pandemic like this gets even more highlighted, exaggerated, where technically 1% of people have 99% of the wealth, right? That's why there have been so many civil wars. Like right now, there are so many shows on TV which talk about this. Like even like right now, what we are facing, the migrant issue where people are going back and, you know, and so how does one navigate this inequality? What is your view on it?
The communist country tried to bring equality. They tried for 40 years and they have been a big failure. You know, they have miserably failed. You know, in society, definitely there will be different classes. And this you cannot totally avoid. But what you can avoid is lessen the gap between the people. It cannot be eliminated, definitely. Those who have should do more charity. And those who are poor, what we need to teach them is not giving them charity, but make them self-reliant, make them stand on their feet, give them that self-respect. On one level, जो गरीब लोग हैं इनके भीतर आत्मबल आत्मसम्मान भरना पड़ेगा. ऑन द अदर साइड कंपैशन देने में जो आनंद है वो उनको सिखाना पड़ेगा जिनके पास है. दे शुड नो दैट देयर इज अ जॉय इन गिविंग.
यस, नाउ कमिंग टू व्हाट वी आर ऑल फेसिंग, द वर्ल्ड इज फेसिंग. सो आई बिलीव विद दिस लॉकडाउन अ लॉट ऑफ माय फ्रेंड्स, यू नो, अ लॉट ऑफ माय फैमिली साइकोलॉजिकली आर एट द टिपिंग पॉइंट. You know, I think though the virus is still to reach its, they call it second wave, they call it its full form, but we are at a tipping point. So are there any kriyas or anything that is simple for people to do to just, you know, calm themselves down?
Yes, yes, meditation. That's why I'm leading people into meditation twice a day, every day. They can learn, do meditation, and they can learn kriya. It just take 3 days, couple of hours, 4 days, couple of hours. And then they can do it. It will make a very big difference for them. And millions are doing this today in the world. Yeah.
And what is your outlook towards Corona right now? What is going to happen?
Well, it has changed the world, the way people were looking at life. It has made a very big difference. And the impact of it will still remain, even after the corona has disappeared. The fear to mingle in groups will continue to be there. I think for at least 1 or 2 years, people will be scared to go for holidays and go out. But one thing is, for the very first time, the entire world know what it is to lock yourself down. मैं तो ये रेकमेंड करूँगा, इवन आफ्टर कोरोना इज ऑल गॉन, एवरी ईयर 1 week लॉकडाउन करना चाहिए. द होल वर्ल्ड शुड ऑब्जर्व 1 week ऑफ लॉकडाउन सो दैट पीपल कैन बी मोर विद देयर फैमिलीज, सिट एंड पॉन्डर अबाउट देमसेल्फ, बी मोर क्रिएटिव, हाँ, गो इनवर्ड एंड बिकम मोर क्रिएटिव. एंड द नेचर कैन रिजुविनेट हरसेल्फ. प्रकृति में एक rejuvenation jo hui hai, air became much purer, water became much purer, and all this started happening. This way we give 1 week for nature to, I think that United Nations should take this up and request all the nations, well prepared lockdown. All the flights are cancelled for 1 week, well in advance. It will make a big difference.
We'll be able to just be then.
You can just be,
which is, we didn't know how to before lockdown. That means even I did, like this time is what you make of it. Gurudev, my last question actually is to deal with which I see a lot of people facing is regret. You know, regret of not being able to do something, regret to not, you know, when if someone's passed away, you regret that you were not there for them. It's almost living in the past, not allowing you to go in the future. Is there anything that, you know, I understand there's meditation, but what would you like to tell these people? Because I have a lot of friends, you know, who live in regret. You meet them and it takes them a lot of time to surpass that.
Let them run. Go for a run on a marathon. Let them swim. Kuch aisi activity karein which requires you to be in the present moment. You know, when you are running, your mind stops. Yoga is very good. Make them do yoga. Yoga, meditation, pranayama. These things they should do. People who sit and regret, keep regretting. It's because the energy is low. Prana is low. We need to do something to bring the prana up. Tabhi to kehte ki jo aise vyakti ke sir pe thande pani dalo, ek baar kaam putenge na, fir usse niklayenge. ये गंगा स्नान का यही महत्व है. जब लोग दुखी होते हैं, ओझिल हो महसूस करते हैं अपने आप को, लगते हैं पाप, रिग्रेट माने एक तरह से पाप, दैट मीन्स यू फील यू आर अ सिन, यू आर रिग्रेटिंग द पास्ट, यू आर टेक देम एंड मेक देम डिप इन गंगा Once you get up from there, that cold water, that shiver, that whole thing shakes your whole energy up. Prana shakti badh jata hai. When the prana becomes higher, you know, regret, anger, jealousy, feeling depressed, all these qualities vanish. People who are in regret simply tell their prana or the level of energy is low. That's all. And it is none of their mistake. This is because we were never taught, neither at school nor at home, how to handle the mind, how to handle our different emotions. By nature, some are able to handle emotion because they were never taught the link between emotions and the breath and the sensation in the body. How when you attend to any of these, you can change the way you are feeling rather than feeling a victim of your own emotions.
Beautifully put, Gurudev. I think this last answer has a lot of impact. I want to ask you one last thing, sorry, before we wind this up. I wanted to understand that, you know, about when my parents, you know, my father used to go to work, my mother used to take care of the house and the family, which I feel is more difficult, if not as difficult as the job. Lately now, what is interesting is that, you know, women are turning out to be better workforce than even men in that sense. What is your view going forward on, you know, like they say in this lockdown, the maximum marriages are falling apart, which sounds funny, but because they finally, you've locked them in a room, so all the elephants are out, right? So what is your view on, you know, marriage and children? How is it going to change in the next 10, 20 years?
When both men and women are individualistic, they need to understand each other. And, you know, in this culture, like Indian culture and Eastern culture, India, or you take China or Japan or the Eastern Hemisphere, and also in the Southern Hemisphere, like Latin America and all. So there is a lot of family values. They still play a very important role in our society, in our lives. I'm sure that will continue. And kids are a big bonding factor here. So with kids playing their role and the parents playing their role, so the generation in between will definitely carry the values. Already we are returning back to values. See, world over, family values are being cared for much more now than say 10 years back. Psychologically, emotionally, and spiritually, also you need this bonding, proper bonding. And it's the bonding that can help one to survive in spite of being very individualistic.
So in a way, that 1 week lockdown every year will make them better equipped to handle it if it happens for so long in 10 years. I think that is the answer for a lot of questions we have. Gurudev, my mother wants to say hello. She's going to come. She's here behind, and she's going to come and.
Namaskar, Guruji.
There.
Namaskar, ma. Kaisi ho?
That's my Namaskar. Wife. Namaskar. So please, this is our little small family. Please do bless us. Yes. And thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Please bless us.
Bas aapke darshan ho gaye, we are blessed. We all are blessed.
Really blessed. Thank you so much.